Hey folks, and welcome back to Replay, a show where games are art. So last time we freed Figaro Castle from the monsters that had taken up residence in it, and now we're able to move on to the rest of the world. So we're finally leaving those first couple of continents and heading off to the Kolingan region. Now, the deserts here do have slightly different enemies than before. Actually, these seem to be the same as the ones in the desert on the other side. But regardless, we're still seeing very much kind of the weird sea creatures on land, that kind of thing. And it's kind of interesting that the enemies here are the weird, not just for the reasons I talked about last time, but also because, in essence, our prior party was the weird. Terra, in particular, was kind of definitionally weird. She was only partially human. She came from outside. Oh yeah, Blob's another good example of weird. Basically anything which is more invertebrate-ish in its biology, or anything which combines features of multiple creatures, will generally be part of the weird. But yeah, all the magic-infused characters kind of fall under the category of the weird. Arguably, the boy raised by animals is weird. Depending on how you interpret Moogles, and here's a nice little bit of memory of the past, which will be important in a moment. But that's clearly something in this town people are holding on to, or at least this old woman is. The point is, the whole party was basically weird. Moogles, for example, are readable as fairy creatures, particularly the fact that they live underground, and you read them as... Oh, here's a clue to Locke's occasion. As mentioned last time, the game seems to be trying to tie together the weird and the chthonic, so that link works. And fairy creatures are almost always weird. In folkloric terms, kind of fairies are the weird, ghosts are the hauntological. Obviously, since that's where the word hauntological comes from, it's hauntings. Yeah, lots of clues in this town to people we left behind. Stuff about memory, a clue to the Colosseum, which is a place where you fight sort of random, depending on what you bet, past enemies, and some new ones. It'll also be later in the game where we find out Shadow's past. There's a lot about memories and the past coming up all of a sudden. Gee, I wonder which character joins us in this town. And that's gonna be pretty significant for the next dungeon. But I don't want to get too much into that until we get there. I'm busy trying to figure out, because I know who we get in this town, I just don't remember where. Nope, none of the beds here are free. I think I mentioned before, this game has a ridiculous number of free inns, but apparently this town is not one of them. Aha! Alright. Let's talk to Setzer. Setzer is kind of weird because he's absolutely critical to the plot of the game exactly twice, once in each world, and I otherwise have no interest in him whatsoever. He doesn't have... Like, most of the characters have a ton of personality. Setzer... not so much? I'm really not sure what his thing. Like, they're saying all these things about him, but I feel like we never saw that. You know, like, we don't need characters to tell us Edgar is a womanizer. We see him being, you know, hitting on everything that moves. Whereas with Setzer, I feel like you never really get into his head very much, except in this sequence. And possibly his crush on Celeste, if that's a thing, it's not really clear. But yes. I do like this game's repeated association between freedom and hope. Like, that was kind of everything the Returners were about. And now that's here. Like, the idea of gaining back our freedom of movement is a major source of hope. Yeah, wow, that's a pretty big difference. So, let's get Setzer equipped. And then let's head... Yeah, okay, that's bad. I don't want that one. Because instant... undead enemies are immune to instant death. And we're going to be fighting a lot of undead enemies. Because, as I've kind of been dropping hints to, the next dungeon is going to be all about the hauntological. That's why we've been getting all this stuff about memory in this town. Because we're headed to a tomb. And it's hard to think of anything more hauntological than a tomb. So let's get a night's rest, and I'll meet y'all at the tomb. So, this is Daryl's tomb. Doesn't look like much from the outside, but there's an enormous amount within, which is very much the way of things with the hauntological. Because the whole idea of the hauntological, where the weird is the invasion from outside, the hauntological is... the bad stuff within, the horror within. And ironically, the first enemy we encounter kind of fits more in the weird, but they are inflicting zombie status on us, so I guess they are supposed to be some kind of undead, and there's nothing more hauntological than that. So the idea of the hauntological is that... Oh, you know, it occurs to me the Drainer Sword's a really bad idea here, too. But, as I was saying, the idea of the hauntological is that there's... the weird is invasion from without. The hauntological is something coming up from within. It's the long-buried secret that comes back to hurt you. It's the ancient curse on your family. It's the ghost haunting you. It's everything inside the body. Blood and guts are a form of hauntological horror. Ghosts are, skeletons are, because those are all, well, except for ghosts, things that are inside you. Ghosts are hauntological because they're memories. And that's the whole thing of the hauntological, is that it's not just what's inside us, but what's behind us. It's our pasts. Wow, I've never even taught him any magic whatsoever. That's amazing. It's our past coming back to haunt us and to, you know, hurt us or punish us for things we did wrong in the past, because that's one of the things that's inside us is our memories, our histories. So, you know, the key idea of the hauntological, the thing that makes the hauntological scary is the ticking clock, the idea that we're running out of time. Because, of course, we all are. We're all mortal. So, what's scary is the idea that you're going to die one day. And the reminder that you're going to die one day. And so, anything associated with death, that's the hauntological. Because that's the time bomb ticking away inside you, is your own death. There can be other time bombs inside you. There can be, like I said, the family curse, or the disease, or anything else that's, you know, inside you and trying to come out. One of the things that makes the movie Alien so brilliant is that it crosses those lines so fluidly, because the alien is simultaneously something growing inside you and this horror from without. It's the weird horror that becomes a hauntological horror that becomes weird again. So here's a familiar enemy from people who've played the series. The Marlboro. I think there's one that's actually called a Marlboro later in the game that's more powerful. But these are one of the most obnoxious and powerful enemies in the series. It's a giant plant monster that generally has some kind of attack that allows it to cause random status ailments, usually really nasty ones. I can't remember in this... Yeah. I'm just gonna have to be careful not to physically attack... Okay, good. I'm gonna have to be careful not to physically attack enemies that are undead, but there's enough that aren't, like the Mad Oscars, that I think I'm okay keeping the trainer. It is still such a great combination with the ammo in it. But yeah, so this dungeon is this interesting combination. We've got weird things, like plant monsters, but we've also got a lot of undead, and we're in a tomb, which is very hauntological. And so it's kind of a shifting away from that. At the same time, this is the dungeon where we're getting the airship. This is, you know, where we're getting our thing that will allow us to meaningfully rebel against Kefka. And the reason is, I think, is that at this point, we are Kefka's hauntological horror. We are a relic of his past. We are a relic of the world before he took over. And so where in the first half of the game, we were very much the weird, and our party was made up of some pretty weird characters. Magic is closely associated with the weird here, because it comes from outside, so to speak. So there's that. There's, sorry, getting distracted, trying to guess if these flowers are safe to hit with the greatsword. But yeah, the party was very weird before. It was all... Did he just attack us? Wonderful. It was all magic users and outsiders and outcasts and a fairy creature. But now we're the returners. We're the world as it was, trying to bring it back. And that makes us, for Kefka... For Kefka, we're the only thing that is really standing up to him. So we're the only thing that he could conceivably be afraid of. And on top of that, we're a relic of the past. We were the ones who opposed him before. So, yeah, in a sense, I think that makes us kind of that which is haunting him. Ooh, first piece of Genji equipment. If I remember correctly, except for specialized stuff, the Genji equipment is the best in the game. And I believe, except for stealing them from enemies in the Colosseum and tricks like that, there's only one of each piece. The Genji helm, Genji armor. Obviously, there's a couple of Genji gloves, since I have them. Yeah, okay, this is not someone I want to hit with the drainer. I guess that makes sense. There does seem to be a skeleton in there. So yeah, that's a corpse possessed by a demon, it looks like. That works in terms of being pretty hauntological. Turtle riding is a strangely prominent theme in the early world of ruin. I'm not entirely clear why. Ah, yes. This silly puzzle. So, very briefly, Squaresoft, who of course are now Square Enix, had a motto, a slogan, "The world is square." It was never really a thing. And then it kind of died out after a pretty short amount of time. So this is, as far as I know, the only game that actually references it. But yes, there's a puzzle where you spell it backwards and get an item. Pretty good item, though it's less useful in this game than it would be in others. Okay. It's a good thing the enemies here drop a ton of those. Now, I don't think I've mentioned this, but I kind of have a thing in games that will let you teach any magic to anyone, where I use my primarily physical characters as out of combat healers. I don't know if other people do that or not. Okay. Yeah. Now, it works like that. That's weird. But yeah, the world is square. I'm not 100% sure if that's actually necessary to get the EXP egg, but it at least tells you where it is. I think it might be necessary to open up that room. I'm not certain. Yeah, I don't know if that's a thing other people do, but I've always liked using, like, having specialized out-of-combat healers, either a character who doesn't use magic in combat, or in some games that allow it, Xenosaga 1 did, I think 2 and maybe 3, where you could have a character that wasn't in combat at all be your healer. Because, like, the whole party was there, but only 3 of them participated in combats. I have to say, I'm not sure the zombie thing makes this dungeon harder. I think it might actually make it easier. Because, like, right now, half my party is immune to damage. And I got what I needed to revive them from the fight. I wonder if I made everyone immune to zombie, would this be harder? Hidden room. Just have to figure out how to get there. Somehow. I don't know, I don't think I want to start a fight with 2 zombies. Probably should have healed them after the last battle. But yeah, it's interesting to try to figure out who Setzer is. All we really know about him is that he's a gambler. Ah, there we go. Yeah. It makes sense that the EXP egg would be here, because again, experience, memory, haunting. You know, as I think I've observed elsewhere, ghosts really are just memories. Where, you know, they're metaphors for the memory of the people who are gone. I think I talked about that in terms of mourning being liminal ages ago. Huh. Now what? Have I ever hit... Anyway, like I was saying, Setzer's not easy to figure out as a character. All we really know about him is that he gambles, and that's just not as strong a personality trait as some of the other characters have. He's not in the story that much. Other than him being a gambler, there's the whole thing where he wanted to kidnap Maria, and it's not clear what Maria's position on that was, because Maria doesn't actually exist in the game. There is no equivalent to her. You never meet an NPC that's like, oh yes, hello, I am Maria. I look exactly like Celeste. So that doesn't help much in figuring him out. Yeah, did I ever hit that switch on the other side of the thing? There we go. Okay. So there's not really much there to talk about with him, except for this. Like, he was once a daredevil. And friends with Daryl, their relationship is not entirely clear. They were lovers or best friends or what. But clearly very close. And he lost her and roamed the world as a gambler. Somehow empire enriched him. It's not clear how. Certainly, he didn't provide them with airships. In fact, it's not entirely clear why he and Daryl had the world's only airships. Did one of them invent them? We don't know. But that's pretty much all we got on Setzer. This sequence coming up is one of the most emotionally affecting in the game. Sorry about that. I think there was a glitch in the game. Scared me for a second. But yeah. There's not really that much else to it. And it's a little strange, actually. Ooh, okay, so ice bad. Fire good. Oh, crap. Slots bad. But like I was saying, it's a little... Oh god. This might kill him. Nobody can remember this. It's a little strange, as I was starting to say, that it should be... This dungeon should be Setzer-themed.
Ooh.
Because... Like, what is he even... What memory is there to him? You know? I guess the idea is an attempt to flesh out his character a little by giving him backstory, but it just doesn't quite gel. He just, like I was saying, he just doesn't have the personality that a lot of the other characters do. you know? Like, Realm has even less story focus than he does, but she comes across as a stronger and more She comes across as a stronger and more likable character because she's got personality. She, you know, her lines of dialogue could not be said by any other character. She has a unique way of speaking. She has a voice. And most of the characters have their own voice. There's a few that don't. Mog really doesn't. Mog doesn't. Setzer doesn't. But most of the cast do have a very strong voice, and Mog is a weird enough character with quirky enough abilities that he can sort of get away with the lack of any real voice. You know, you don't really expect the cute thing to have a strong voice. Setzer's got nothing. You know? All he's got is hint of a tragic backstory. And in a game like this, where there's so little space for story and so much has to be filled in by the player, the lack of voice is a real problem. You know, and I don't get a read on his character. Is he, like, reckless kind of a gambler, or is he stoic, doesn't care what the outcome is, or, you know, is he cynical and resigned? It's hard to say. You know? That is definitely an improvement. So, let's save up because the game is being slightly buggy and there's a boss battle coming. I haven't seen any more glitches like that though, so that's good. Oh, yes, that weapon is a good weapon. Instant death on male characters, I believe. Or human characters. Enemies, I mean. So, coming up at the end of this hallway is what might seem like a boss from nowhere. Because it kind of does attack from nowhere with no dialogue, and if you're not familiar with the folklore, no indication of what it is. I did not like that order of items. Alright, I think we're good. Alright. Daryl sleeps here. Yep, just straight to this boss fight. But if you're familiar with the folklore, you'll know this is a Dullahan. I mean, obviously, that's what it's called. But there's a few things notable about that. The Dullahan is a figure from Irish folklore. Irish? Gaelic. Irish. And it is, as you can kind of see here, it's the Headless Horseman, originally. This is more of a charioteer and looks a little bit like he does have a head, but, you know, artist interpretation. He's got the key elements, the whip that looks like it's made from a human spine, the spectral horse, the fact that he is clearly some variant of undead. But you'll notice he's attacking us with light magic. This is not an evil being. What exactly the Dullahan does is not entirely clear. But basically, it rides around and stops to tell people it is their time to die. Similar to a banshee or creatures like that. It's a signal that death is nigh. And anyone who interferes with it becomes its enemy and is attacked. So in a way, the Dullahan is readable as a good thing. It's a warning. But it's also, you know, frightening, because it means we're going to die. It's that, you know, it's the perfect enemy for that hauntologicalness, because that's what the hauntological is all about, the fear of death. And it's interesting to me that it attacks with ice and light, because that's Celeste. That's everything that her character is about. And, you know, she's one of the three characters you're absolutely required to have for this fight. So, you know, with Celeste, it's a reference to the heavenly, the celestial. And I think that's what's going on here, too, except here it's the sense of the heavenly as in the hereafter, as in the afterlife. The cold of death, the spectral light. Man, this thing hits hard. And it heals itself. Note, too, that it is not actually undead. It is healed by heal spells, not hurt by them. It is not itself one of the dead. Oh, I forget what the best way to remove that. Let's heal up first, and then... Wow. As I was saying, it's not actually dead itself. It's... death. It's a warning of the end. Well, okay, that's one way to get rid of being frozen. You also note that the amount of damage it does per hit is incredibly variable. And it does status attacks and level. It did a level question mark pearl at the beginning. Those are all chance-based abilities. So it's a reflection of both Celeste and Setzer. It's the coming together of the two. The randomness of Setzer and the ice and light of Celeste. Basically, it's far from being random boss from nowhere, it's actually a really thematically solid concept that isn't spelled out. So, you know, I wish more random bosses from nowhere were like the Dullahan or Ultros, where there is actually a really good thematic sense to them. Okay, that did not actually kill me. Now it's just a matter of waiting for this jerk to die. Oh, yeah. Oh, and I almost got to do the bombing run on him. That's one of my favorite slot results. And again, there's that whole thing with the memory. Okay. So maybe they did invent the airship together or something. The faster airship being called the Falcon is probably another Star Wars reference, like Biggs and Wedge. But it doubles as a reference to Final Fantasy IV, where the two main airships in the game were the Enterprise and the Falcon, referring, of course, to Star Trek and Star Wars. And the Big Whale, referring to, as far as I know, nothing. But here we get the Blackjack, presumably because after the crash of the Falcon, Setzer decided that he would make a better airship with Blackjack and hookers. And then forgot the Blackjack and hookers. Did the Blackjack have Blackjack tables? I don't think it did. I think it just... Maybe it did. And yeah. Daryl flew too high. And too fast and died. She took one risk too many. It's fascinating that he decided to completely fix it up. Of course, Edgar would have heard of it, a feat of engineering like this. Here it is. Some of the best music in the series. This theme is amazing. Just the massive turnaround this music represents. The first really upbeat music, other than that brief glimpse of Setzer's theme, I guess Figaro Castle. But this is just a massive change. Also, there's that bird again. Celeste has had great success before with being inspired by birds, which makes sense. Again, her association with the heavens and the sky and so forth. And yeah, the bird guiding us to Zozo, I believe. But we're not going to go there yet. Because there's some other stuff I want to take care of first. But yeah. One of the great things here. This is now the overworld music. Like, that dark, depressing theme from before is completely gone. It does not play again. There is only this song. And what a great song it is. Right. Okay. I'm remembering how this works now. We get a clue here to where Cyan is hiding out. But like I said, don't want to do that first. There's somewhere else I want to check out before that happens, which is heading back to Terra again. After all, we've reclaimed the skies, changed the map music. Now let's get back to the Earth. Not to mention, now that we've achieved kind of this fusion of the hauntological and the weird in ourselves, let's go get the character who represents that union of different things, that combination of what's inside the human and what's outside. Terra. Plus, you know, round two with, right. I can't remember if we knew before that Katarin's pregnant or just that they were, like, a thing, but yep. Terra's gonna be a grandma. 22 is pretty young for that. So is Terra... Yeah, I'm pretty sure Katarin was not pregnant the last time I was here. But, yeah. So like I was saying, Terra is, again, that combination of... Okay, I think that's everybody. Different, okay, yeah, Terra must be with Katarin. She's that combination of difference. The human Esper, our world, the other world. And she's also kind of a living embodiment of the long ago crime of what humans did to the Espers. Thank you, puppy, for showing me the way. And I think it's actually really kind of fitting that this cannot happen until after you have the airship. Meaning, so once you get the airship, the order in which you do things in the world of Ruin is pretty flexible. But this cannot happen until after you get the airship, which is to say, you cannot find out about this new life on the way until you've gone down into the depths and the land of the dead and dealt with that. So, Humbaba. I mentioned last time I couldn't remember what Humbaba was, but in between, I looked it up. Humbaba is a Babylonian demon mentioned as the guardian of the cedar forest in... the Epic of Gilgamesh. So, one of the oldest fictional characters we know of, given that the Epic of Gilgamesh is the oldest piece of writing that we know. I should say oldest piece of fiction. We have stuff like receipts from older than that. I kid you not, the oldest known piece of writing is a receipt. Poison. Do I have that? Pretty sure I do. Let's give him some more. Hmm. Funbaba was, like I said, the guardian of the cedar forest, which belonged to the gods, and which Gilgamesh... That's not helpful, Edgar. Which Gilgamesh raided. And he was said to have the horns to be... If I remember correctly, he is said to be green. He is definitely said to have the horns of a bull, which, yes. And the claws of a vulture on his feet, which, yeah, kind of. And to just generally be huge and muscular. And have the head of a snake on the end of his tail, which they didn't do here, but they did give him kind of a lizardy tail. Oh, and he was said to have scales, which he does on his back. So, overall, pretty accurate to the legend. Okay, fire I can work with. Great. Alright. Do you have... Yes. Yeah, let's... I want Celeste to have a weakness in him to take advantage. Ugh. This is really frustrating. Baba Brand. Oh, right. Getting rid of two characters. And now, finally, to protect her loved ones, Terra's power is fully unlocked. Because, of course, her power is fully unlocked by love. She is a magical girl, after all. Yeah, the Morph Command isn't even there, because it can't wear off in this fight. Yeah, he's weak to poison, all right. Ow. That wasn't that bad. Alright, I'm gonna have her stick to bio. And I think I'll have Celeste either ice or heal as needed. See how weak the debilitator makes him. Not bad. Not bad at all. I think we've got this fight down. It's interesting, too, that Terra's morph form emerges from inside of her, but is in itself weird. It's, again, that combination of the two ideas. It's the Sculptus. It's Alien, referring to the movie. It's the thing which crosses over between both. Because, of course, stuff can easily do so. It is, after all, a spectrum, not a binary. I have to wonder if this is the real reason Terra found herself unable to use her powers, is less that she no longer felt, you know, that she no longer felt like fighting, and more that she was afraid of rejection by her new family if they saw what she really was. She was afraid of losing them. And when Funbaba became a more immediate threat that she might lose them, she became willing to do it. Of course, as it turns out, they all still love her anyway. Aww. But no, this is a legitimately sweet scene. And again, it's really refreshing, especially in this time, to have really the primary, most blatant love story in the game be parental love. Now, there is a bit of a downside here. While that's a great break from cliche, there's still a case to be made that very often magical girls graduate out of being a magical girl into being a mom. As opposed to being kind of this border boundary straddling figure of transgressive power that a magical girl can be, they become the mom. They become a nurturing figure who is themselves not active. Madoka Kaname, arguably Sailor Moon versus Queen Serenity, that kind of thing. And arguably that's what happened with Terra, except that she does join us and she does go out to fight to protect her family. So a little bit of a difference there. Let's look around a little bit. It's back here. Oh, wait, this is the place I know. So yeah, the other problem here is fighting for the future of our children, which sounds great, but in practice can be really gross. Because you end up with the child. You end up with this mythical figure that you never actually see, who doesn't actually exist, and who everything has to be done for. This is an idea called reproductive futurism. The idea that the point of life is to make a better world for our children, which in practice is used to excuse some really kind of horrifying things. You know, in particular, homophobia, transphobia, that kind of thing, is frequently couched in terms of for the children, while ignoring the fact that these hurt actual living children, but the children, as this nebulous concept, are treated as being more important. It also tends to shade very easily into heteronormativity and related issues. So it's a little bit of an iffy thing, but then on the other hand, it's not being presented as the reason everybody's doing what they're doing. It's being represented as a reason, specifically Terra's reason. And so it's less a matter of, you know, the children, and more this is what Terra has found for herself in her world. I am probably never going to use Setzer again for the rest of the game. Just a heads up. I just don't find him that interesting of a character, and slot, as the game goes on, becomes not useful. So, one last quick thing I'm going to do, and then I think I'll call it a day. Once I've re-equipped everyone. Yeah, Terra's going to take over the Drainer combo. And the best equipment, because Terra. And I'm sorry, but I've just always liked her better than Celeste. I can't help that. So, now off to the other thing I want to do, as soon as I remember where it is. Somewhere in this part of the world, I thought it's her. I am looking for a cross-shaped formation of trees. Alright, so after like 10 minutes of searching, I finally found what I was looking for. Are you serious? That's not even remotely funny. What even is this thing? Okay. Now that that's out of the way. This is what I was looking for. Remember this house from way back in the World of Balance? Turns out Duncan's still alive. No explanation given. I mean, he gives one, but no explanation given of why he didn't come back before. I guess his wife was right that he's not really dead. I guess that was Vargas's attempt to kill him? Or is he referring to the world being torn apart? I don't really know. But yeah. You get to have a little training montage. I do really like the bit where they stop in the middle of training to talk. And now we know the bum rush. The most powerful of Saban's blitzes. So yeah, a lot of reaching into the past. We confronted our mortality and then confronted relics of the past. A good session. Next time, I think I'm probably going to go recruit Saban. Cyan, and whatever else happens next time. See y'all then. Bye.